Hello, I am Dr. Jabeel Abbas from the Physiology Department, and today my lecture is in continuation with the countercurrent mechanism, and today we are going to discuss the role of ADH. We have discussed that how the hyperosmolarity of the medulla is created, and then we have seen that how it is maintained by the vasa recta. And today we are going to see how this whole system, that is the hyperosmolarity of the medulla, is utilized by the ADH. Actually, ADH is the supreme power who is going to utilize whole this setup. So what is meant by the ADH, how it is going to, what is going to do with you? And this is the ADH which is responsible for the production of a dilute urine or a concentrated urine. This all because of ADH, and ADH is the actually the main user of this hyperosmolarity of the medulla. And this diagram is self-explanatory, that if you are traveling in a desert and you have got a single drop of water, then you have to say that thank God we have got the ADH, because it is because of the ADH that you can survive in such an environment with a very small amount of water. So what is ADH, from where it is coming? Let's see in detail. So ADH and osmoreceptors, these are the receptors which are going to receive the changes in the osmolarity, and the thirst centers. These are actually one and the same thing. So we are going to study mainly the ADH, but at the same time we are going to see the osmoreceptors and the thirst center, because the thirst centers, osmoreceptors, ADH, they are present in the same areas of the brain. So ADH is secreted by the, it is coming from the hypothalamus. And these are the, here you can see, these are the main nuclei, the paraventricular nucleus, and this is supraoptical nucleus, supraoptic nucleus. This is the deep yellow color of the nucleus, and this purple color triangular nucleus. These two nuclei, this nucleus and this one, these two are responsible for the production of the hormone ADH, antidiuretic hormone. So the antidiuretic hormone, the other name for this is vasopressin, because it causes the vasoconstriction. That's why this is also known as the vasopressin. This is also known as arginine vasopressin, because arginine is amino acid is present in it. And this hormone, the ADH, antidiuretic hormone, which is produced from this area and from this area, this hormone is a very strong vasoconstrictor, very strong vasoconstrictor. Now, there are different areas in the brain. One of them is very important. Now, ADH is synthesized in the supraoptic, as you have seen in the previous diagram, supraoptic nucleus and magnocellular. This is the type of the cells which are present in the supraoptic. These are magnocellular nucleus. This is 5-6, if you make 6 parts of this ADH, 6 part means quantity wise, that means 5th of 5 parts of the 6th is produced by the supraoptic nucleus, and very less, 1-6th is produced by the paraventricular nucleus. So the supraoptic nucleus is mainly responsible for the production of the ADH. Then, from after its production, it is released to the posterior pituitary, then it is moved down through the nerves and it is stored in the posterior pituitary, and that is finally it is released from the posterior pituitary. It is, you can see in this diagram that once it is produced, most of it is produced from the supraoptic, and less of them is, once it's produced from the paraventricular nucleus. And after its production from these two areas, it moves down here, follow my cursor, moves down, it is stored in the posterior pituitary. In the posterior pituitary, and very important, another hormone is stored, that is the oxytocin. And keep in mind that the oxytocin and your ADH, structurally they are very close to each other. Their chemical structure is very close, and some of their function is also overlapping. So posterior pituitary is the storehouse for the ADH and the vasopressin. So both of these hormones is stored in this area, the posterior pituitary. Now, osmoreceptors. What is meant by the osmoreceptors? That these are those receptors which are stimulated by 1% increase in the osmolarity of the extracellular fluid, or you can say, and 10% decrease in the blood volume, decrease in the blood pressure, and induced thirst. Let's see in detail. Osmoreceptors, they are present. We are later on we'll see in detail where they are present, but their stimulation is either the 1% increase in osmolarity. That means if you take more salt in your body, if you take more salt in your diet, definitely your osmolarity is going to increase. So if your osmolarity is increased just by 1%, you have to take the water just to neutralize that excess of the sodium in your body. This is the one way. Second is, if you have got the bleeding, unfortunately, if you bleed and your blood volume decreases by the 10%, then again osmoreceptors are going to be stimulated. Now you can well understand that if there is a bleeding, suppose if there is unfortunately the roadside accident and you have got the bleeding at that time, unfortunately, then your blood pressure, when the bleeding will be there, definitely blood volume will decrease, and this, when the blood volume will be lower down, your blood pressure is going to down, and both these things is going to stimulate your osmoreceptors, and at the same time they are going to induce the thirst. You will feel more thirst for the water. Now these osmoreceptors, where they are found? These osmoreceptors are found in the subfornical organ. Then another area which is known as the AV3V, antroventral region of the third ventricle. Then another very important organ, organum vasculosum of the lamina terminalis. Then blood supply to these areas lack blood-brain barrier. That means the blood-brain barrier is a barrier which is present, that everything cannot enter into your blood matter, into your brain matter. So that blood-brain barrier, which is the main barrier, that is not present over here. Then lesions of the antroventral region of the third ventricle will create problem in the ADH secretion, thirst, sodium appetite, and the blood pressure. Now let's see the diagram where this area, that is antroventral region of the third ventricle, organum vasculosum of the lamina terminalis, where they are present actually. Let's see the diagram. In this diagram you can see that these are the areas, these are the known as subfornical organs. These are three regions of the brain process of thirst. So subfornical area, this is your subfornical area. Then median preoptic nucleus, this reddish one is the median preoptic nucleus. Then this organum vasculosum of the lamina terminalis. So mainly these are the three areas. They are well explained in the next diagram. Here you can see this is a subfornical organ. This area is a subfornical organ. Actually here your angiotensin 2 is going to stimulate this area for the increased intake of the water, for the increase in water intake. This subfornical organ. Then here you have got the organum vasculosum of the lamina terminalis. This is the area. Here your osmoreceptors are present. Then this is your posterior pituitary, where there is storage of the hormones from where they are going to be released. And then this is the area postrema. This is a chemoreceptor trigger zone that initiates vomiting in response to chemical changes in the blood. And that means if there is a more sodium in your body or other chemical changes, so you may feel vomiting. That is stimulated by this area. This area is not concerned with our topic actually. We are concerned with the subfornicular organ. We are concerned with the organa vasculosum of the lamina terminalis and the posterior pituitary. These are the main area. These are also known as the circumventricular organs. That is, they make a circle around the ventricular organ. So, circumventricular organs. Now, here you can see the paraventricular nucleus and the supraoptical nucleus. These two nuclei, they secrete your ADH or the vasopressin, and it is transferred through hypothalamus, hypophyseal tract, down into the posterior pituitary, where they are going to be stored along with the oxytocin, and from here they are going to be released. Now, what are the main stimulants for the production of the ADH? Now you can see the increased ADH. If you study this one, definitely it will be opposite to this one. Now, increase it is that if the plasma osmolarity is increased, you have seen that if the 1% increase in the osmolarity, there will be secretion, increased secretion of the ADH. Then if the blood volume, as we have seen previously, if the person is going to bleed, blood volume is decreased, blood pressure will decrease, and these two things, they are going to secrete more and more ADH just to preserve the water. Then nausea, it is also loss of water, hypoxia. These are the things which are going to secrete more and more ADH. Then different drugs like morphine, nicotine, cyclophosphamides. These are the drugs which are concerned with the excess of the ADH. They are going to stimulate the production of more and more ADH. And on the opposite side, if you study at the same time one by one, increase osmolarity, more ADH. Opposite, if the plasma osmolarity is decreased, definitely there will decrease ADH. If blood volume is more, decrease ADH. If blood pressure is more, decrease ADH. Now let's see why it is decrease and increase ADH. Actually, ADH is anti-diuretic hormone. That means diuresis means more urine. Anti-diuresis means less urine, or anti to the diuresis. That means due to the effect of ADH, or the main function of the ADH is to reduce the urine quantity. So ADH, definitely when you need more water in your body, whenever, like in the hot water, whenever you need more water, for example, if you have taken more salt, you need more water to neutralize or to maintain the osmolarity. Or if you have got bleeding, to decrease, definitely blood volume is going to low. At the same time, blood pressure is going to low. You need more water to regularize or to neutralize all these things. And whenever you need more water in your body, you need ADH for this. And ADH will function. Next, we are going to study all these things. Then very important is alcohol. Alcohol drinking, alcohol also going to cause decrease in ADH. So when you take the alcohol, when you drink alcohol, at that time, what happens? You have got less ADH and you have got more urine. Then another drug, clonidine, which is a blood pressure lowering drug, is going to cause diuresis. Then haloperidol. This haloperidol is used in psychiatry, is dopamine blocking drugs. This excess of the dopamine, you know that when the dopamine is less in your body, it's going to cause some diseases. When it's more, if it is excess in your body, is again going to cause some diseases. So haloperidol, clonidine, alcohol, these are the things which are going to decrease the ADH secretion. Now, what are the sequence of the events? Now, whenever the plasma osmolarity is increased, it will cause intracellular dehydration of the thirst centers. That means thirst center, they become dehydrated. Now, decrease extracellular blood volume. This is the second way. This is the first way that you can say the one way, the increased plasma osmolarity. Simply to understand, if you have taken more salt, if you have taken more sodium chloride in your diet, then you have to take the extra water. Then Decrease in extra blood volume. If you have got, unfortunately, if you've got hemorrhage, bleeding, definitely it will cause the stimulation of thrust. Then angiotensin 2, it directly diffuses into the thrust centers. Then dryness of the mouth and the mucosal membranes. Then gastrointestinal tract and pharyngeal stimulation influence the thrust and meter it. Meter it means that if meter it, it means how much water required by you, or when your feeling of thirst is vanished or finished, is when we meter it. So all these things are going to stimulate your thirst centers. Same diagrams, you have seen this one. These are the diagram which are showing where they are produced. Now, this diagram is self-explanatory. This is a just, you can say, sum up. We are going to sum up all these things. But before that, I would like to make the you understand the action of the, or you can say, mechanism of action of the vasopressin hormone. Primarily, it has got two functions. One is to retain the water in the body. Second is the constriction of the blood vessels. That means to raise the blood pressure. And the third function of this anti-diuretic hormone, that it is directly released into your brain and it plays a very important role in the social behavior, sexual behavior, motivation, peer bonding, and maternal responses to the stress. And very important short line which is concerned with your MCQ, half-life is 16 to 24 minutes. You can say roughly less than half an hour. Less than our half hour is the half life is. Now we will see one very important thing, how it is going to retain, how the water is going to be retained by the presence of the ADH. For this we have to see one very important thing, that is the principal cells. Here you can see this is the your cut section of the distal convoluted tubule and the medullary collecting ducts. The green ones are the principal cells. 90% of this area, distal convoluted tubule having the principal cell, and this principal cell is function to absorb sodium and the water and to lose the potassium. And these principal cells, basically these principal cells are the site of action of aldosterone and the ADH, both are going to act through this. So principal cells are responsible for the reabsorption of the water and the sodium. So these are the intercalated cells. We will see later on in the, this is concerned with the hydrogen secretion, they are concerned with the other things. We will see later on the bicarbonate level, all these things, but at this moment concentrate only on the principal cells. Now, then another terminology over here. One is known as the hypovolemic thrust and other is the osmotic thrust. Osmotic thrust means if you take more, suppose you take more meat, meat has got a very heavy amount of salt. So if you take more meat, suppose you have taken, it's common experience all of us that if you take more meat in your diet, you feel more thirsty. That means if you take more sodium in your diet, then that is osmotic thirst. And to neutralize this more sodium in your body, you have to take more water. This is known as osmotic thirst. And second is known as the hypovolemic thirst. That if you got, unfortunately, if you got bleeding, hemorrhage, then definitely your blood volume is going to be decreased. And then this decrease in blood volume also stimulates your thrust center, and this is known as the hypovolemic thrust. Now we have seen in the previous diagram, I have to search for that diagram which is very important. Just wait. Here the diagram. We have seen that this is, you can say, a broader deep yellow color line, or you can say to some extent brownish line. This area, this whole area, this area, this is the ascending part of the thick ascending limb of the lupa malleus. This is your distal convoluted tubule and your outer, your, you can say, the medullary collecting duct. This is medullary collecting duct, this is the cortical collecting duct, these are inner medullary duct. So this area from here, follow my cursor, from here up to all this area is normally impermeable to the water. And this area also has got a rich quantity or a very heavy quantity of the principal cells, which are the site of action of the ADH. So the main function to understand for the ADH is that whenever ADH will come out from the posterior pituitary, it will make this area permeable to the water. It will make this area, which where my cursor is there, normally this area is impermeable to the water. So water cannot move out from this area. But in the presence of the ADH coming from the posterior pituitary, this area will become permeable to the water, and water is going to be reabsorbed from this area. From here, it's going back to the blood. It's going back to the blood. This is a very important function. So whenever you want to conserve the water, suppose in the hot weather, in the hot weather you need to retain the water because water loss is also occurring from the sweating. So you need more water to conserve your body. So ADH will come out. That ADH will make this area permeable to the water after showing its effect on the principal cell, and the principal cell is going to reabsorb water. But here one thing very important, that ADH causes the pure water reabsorption, solute free reabsorption, that is sodium free reabsorption of the water ADH, while for the conservation or you for the retention of the sodium, the aldosterone is going to cause the sodium reabsorption. But that aldosterone not only causes the reabsorption of sodium, but also the reabsorption of the water along with it. But the ADH causes only and only the pure reabsorption of the water from this area. This is the main action. Second is that it makes this area where my cursor is there, more permeable to the urea by the stimulating the urea transporters. Urea transporters are coming here. Here in this area, ADH is going to produce more aquaporins. Aquaporins are actually the what channels, proteins are they are the channels, protein channels which are responsible for the reabsorption of the water. So ADH produce aquaporin in this area, and also it causes more and more urea reabsorption from this area along with the water. So water is reabsorbed not only from this area, but the ADH causes a reabsorption of the urea and the water from this area also. So this is the main function. Let's see this thing in another diagram. Here you can see the animation. Here the ADH will come out in the red zone. Here the from the blood actually, here the ADH is coming up. This ADH is going to attach it and to its receptors. This is a receptor for the ADH, and it causes the conversion to ATP into cyclic AMP. You see cyclic AMP, you will see again. Repeat it, the ADH from here join with the receptor, convert ATP into cyclic AMP. This cyclic AMP is going to cause a change the protein kinase A. Again, my cursor is at the protein kinase A. And this protein kinase, sorry. Sorry, wait a minute. This protein kinase A is going to change the protein into aquaporin. These are the proteins, these are aquaporins which are produced over here, and these are placed on the apical surface, and this apical surface is going to cause the reabsorption of the water. Here's the water molecule, this is the water molecule, these are the aquaporin. They are produced, attached to the apical surface, and the water is reabsorbed through them. So here is, you found the ADH to my cursor. Here is the ADH, and this ADH, all the sequence is there until the water reabsorption is there. So the main function of the ADH is to conserve water or to reabsorb the water when you need more water in your body. This was all. And second thing is that it is going to cause the vasoconstriction to raise the blood pressure. Now in this diagram, you can well understand the thing. So if there is a hypovolemic thirst or osmotic thirst, that is more sodium leading to the stimulation of the center, or decrease in the volume, bleeding leading to the thirst stimulation, all these things, what they are going to do. If there is hypovolemia due to the bleeding or due to the, you can say, dehydration, what we all in the diarrhea, what will happen? On one side, the cardiac baroreceptor, because the blood pressure is going to lower down, that will stimulate the cardiac baroreceptor. They will going to stimulate your brainstem centers, and ultimately your preoptic area is going to be stimulated. Preoptic area, what is meant by this one? Actually, this is the preoptic nucleus of the hypothalamus. And on the other side, same hypovolemia. It will here. Cardiac baroreceptors, why they are going to be stimulated? Because decrease in the blood pressure. And at the same time, this hypovolemic thrust is going to stimulate the kidney baroreceptor. They will produce more angiotensin 2. This angiotensin 2 is going to stimulate subfornicular organs. You have seen in the diagram where they are present. And it is going to stimulate again to the same preoptic nucleus of the hypothalamus. Then, on the other side, if you have taken more sodium in your diet, unfortunately, if you have taken more sodium in your diet, then what will happen? It will stimulate organum vasculasm of the lamina terminalis. This is stimulated, and it is going to further stimulate the same nucleus. So all these things, whether from this side or from this side, final effect is on the preoptic nucleus of the hypothalamus. So this thing, this preoptic area, this is going to stimulate the supraoptic nucleus, then the paraventricular nucleus, then the hypothalamic thrust neck center. This will cause ultimately more drinking of the water, and on the other side, this thing, the thrust center will be stimulated. So this preoptic area, when the preoptic area of the hypothalamus is stimulated, inside it, you have got two nuclei, as I've told you, supraoptic nucleus, the paraventricular nucleus, both they are going to be stimulated, and they will cause release of the ADH hormone, and water is going to be conserved, water is going to be retained in your body. On the other side, the thirst center will be stimulated, it will cause drinking of the more water. So on one side, you are drinking more water, on the other side, you are going to conserve the water, retain your body. This whole mechanism involved in case of whether you feel the thirst due to hypovolemia or you feel thirst due to the more sodium in your body. All these things ultimately act through hypothalamus in two ways. On one side, you are drinking more water, on the other side, you will try to conserve the water in your body. So here's the diagram. You can see how you can produce a dilute urine. So dilute urine means no ADH or less ADH. So whenever there is a less ADH, definitely you are seeing that there is no water reabsorption on this area. And this area, which are the filtrate coming out having the 100 osmolarity, it remains same. So mechanism is decrease in ADH, release and reduce water permeability in the distal and the collecting ducts. This is the mechanism of production of dilute urine. Now how you are going to produce more concentrated urine? That is, you need more ADH hormone. Here you can see that ADH levels are high. Now here you have got the two arrows. In the previous diagram, you have got only one arrow. This is the effect of aldosterone actually. And here you have got this arrow. This arrow is under the effect of the ADH. So ADH is going to cause more and more reabsorption from this area. So this was all about the ADH. Now let's see the abnormalities in the ADH production. So in this diagram, there is a comparison when there is ADH and when there is no ADH. This is self-explanatory diagram that you can see that ADH is present. So when the ADH is present, water is reabsorbed, water is reabsorbed, water is reabsorbed. You can see water is reabsorbed over here. But this sky blue color of arrows, you can see sky blue arrows. And when there is no ADH, now there is no arrows. You can see there is no arrows. So when these no arrows, that means large volume with here, the water is back to the blood. So no water is allowed to leave your body. Small volume of concentrated urine, that is small volume, that means less water. Concentrated means more solute. But here in this diagram, you will see the large volume, that is more water or diluted urine. See? Although you are going to lose the same amount of the solutes, but because of the large, but with the large amount of the water. Wait for a minute. Let's see. Another thing very important, which is known as the diabetes insipidus. Diabetes mellitus is something different, and diabetes insipidus is something different. This diagram is also self-explanatory, that this person or this woman is drinking much more water. That means this woman is very, very thirsty. Why? Diabetes, that is diabetic patient. Diabetic means diabetic patient. Sorry, I'm using long word, diabetic. Actually, diabetic, we use the word for the diabetes mellitus. Here it is a diabetes insipidus. This diabetes insipidus, what is meant by? Here is a very good diagram. This diagram shows that the ADH is acting like a wrench to open the tap. How much water? ADH is responsible that how much water should be removed from the body. It is the responsibility of the ADH. So if the ADH concentration is less, what will happen? If the ADH, definitely when the ADH concentration is less, there will be more and more water loss will be there. And if the ADH is more in your body, definitely what will happen? If ADH more, then water will be retained in the body. So we are at this moment concerned with the diabetes insipidus, in which your ADH level in your body is less than the normal. So why it is less? It may be due to some head injuries, it may be due to the posterior pituitary tumors, it may be due to the surgeries on the head, which are known as craniotomies. So whenever you have undergone a surgery like craniotomy means when you cut the scalp with the help of a saw, that is craniotomy, or unfortunately when there is a pituitary tumor, or whenever there is a head injury, then there may be a problem in the secretion of the ADH, and ADH quantity in your body is less. So whenever the ADH is less, what will happen to your body? Definitely when the ADH is less, there is no reabsorption of the water. So you have to remove more and more from water from your body. You can pass up to 20 liters of the urine per day, while your normal urine production is just 1.5 liters. And when you pass more water, definitely your specific gravity, that means heaviness, that is concentration of solute, and that water will be reduced. Then two types of the diabetes insipidus. First, you will see the center normal person. This is on this side, you have got a normal person. His pituitary gland is normal. It is producing normal amount of ADH. And this ADH is going to affect his kidneys and causes the reabsorption of the water. And there is a standard output of the urine, that is 1.5 liter of the cell, of a normal color. But here you can see the patient has got a diabetes, although this diabetes insipidus of two types. One of them is known as central diabetes. Central diabetes means this is one is central diabetes, other is known as nephrogenic diabetes. We will see later on nephrogenic. Here, we see the central diabetes. That means your pituitary gland is not produced. Pituitary gland is not producing enough ADH. So the quantity of the ADH is less. When the ADH is not there, you see here your green zero ADH present, green arrows. Here there is no arrow, no ADH. Is no cross, no ADH. So when there is no ADH, so what will happen? You are not able to conserve the water in your body. There is no reabsorption of the water from the distal convoluted tubule and the medullary collecting ducts. What will happen when there is no absorption? So more and more water will be lost in the urine. Here you have got full glass of water. Here you have got less than half. Here you have got past full glass of water. That is, you have produced more and more urine. So if the diabetes is due to the non-production or less production of ADH from the pituitary, the diabetes insipidus is known as the central diabetes. Now, here you have got the comparison of the central diabetes insipidus and the nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. Actually, in the nephrogenic diabetes, the quantity of the ADH secreted from this posterior pituitary is normal. In the central diabetes, it is not produced. Here is the, you have got the crossover. There is no production of ADH from the posterior pituitary. So no ADH and the water reabsorption is not there, dilute urine. But here, the production is normal. There is no crossover here. What is going to happen? Production is normal, but the receptors for the ADH in the distal convoluted tubule and the collecting ducts, they become resistant. They are not ready to accept the command given by the ADH. So ADH quantity is normal. It normally it is produced from the, this is your paraventricular nucleus, supraoptical nucleus. Sorry. They are produced normally, but the receptors present over here to receive this command, they become resistant. They are not ready to accept the ADH. So what will happen? These receptors, when they are not functioning, ADH is there, they are not functioning, what will happen? Again, the result is same, the dilute urine. So whether the ADH is not produced over from here or it is not effective over here, in both these cases, there will be a diabetes insipidus, but there will be a difference. That if you give an injection of ADH to both these patients, do you think so? What will happen? How you can differentiate between this type of the diabetes, nephrogenic, and the central diabetes? Here there is no ADH. Here there is ADH is present. So if you give an injection of ADH, you can see you give already prepared ADH, or you can say genetically engineered prepared ADH, you give in the form of injection to the patient. Which of them, either this one and this one, is going to correct itself? Which will show the results? Think for a minute. Definitely sure this patient, because here there is no ADH and you have given the ADH and rest of the things are normal. So if you provide ADH, the patient become normal. So here ADH is already present. If you give more ADH, the problem is not with the ADH production, problem is the resistance with the receptors. So you cannot correct it by giving ADH. So these patients of the nephrogenic diabetes, they will still show no result. They will still remain, the patient remains as it is, if, even if you give the injection of ADH. But if you give the injection of ADH in this central diabetes, the patient will show the result and it will become all right. So this was all about the central diabetes insipidus and the nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. This another thing which is known as the, inappropriate ADH secretion. Actually, it is known as the syndrome of inappropriate ADH. Or you can say effects of more ADH in your body. So in the previous diabetes insipidus, we have seen that what were the effects of less ADH. Here If the ADH is more in your body, if the ADH become more in your body, so what will happen? Definitely you see in this diagram that SADH, sorry, this is the increased level of the ADH. It will cause more and more reabsorb. It will make renal tubules, that is distal convoluted tubule, it will make it more permeable to the water. More water reabsorption will be there. So when there is more water reabsorption, it will stimulate the production of the more, it will decrease the production of aldosterone. On the other side, when the more water reabsorption, water will be accumulated in your body and less in the urine. So water will be the less in urine. So decrease urine volume, increase urine osmolality. That means volume is less, but solute concentration will be the more. That means increased sodium, urine level of sodium will be more there. And on the other side, when you conserve water, you retain more water in your body, at that time you increase your blood volume. It will cause increased serum hypoosmolality. So blood volume is more, but sodium level is there will be diluted. That means due to the excess of the water in your body, your solute is going to be diluted and it will cause dilutional hyponatremia. That means actually sodium level is same, but due to the excess retention of the water, you have to face the dilutional hyponatremia. So when the sodium level is dilution or diluted or less, it will also cause the decreased aldosterone. Now, when this hyponatremia, it will cause anorexia, that is less appetite, nausea, vomiting, irritability, confusion, hallucinations, that you will see that something is calling you, actually there is no sound. You will visualize something falsely, these are hallucinations, seizure, that fits. You may feel the tremors. So, syndrome of inappropriate secretion of the ADH. This is the syndrome of inappropriate, SIADH. Syndrome of inappropriate secretion of ADH. But dear student, this is really asked in your question, but more important to understand is your diabetes insipidus actually. Here, you can say syndrome of inappropriate secretion. This diagram is self-explanatory, that what happens to the diabetes insipidus and what happens to the syndrome of, that is more ADH and less ADH. Less ADH, you will lose water, you will see lose water and water content in your body is less. And when there is more ADH, you have got more water in your body and leading to the symptoms produced over here.